All right. Hello, I'm Christian. Do we have a slide right here? Who am I? I'm Christian. I'm a co-founder and CTO of Peakon. I previously worked as CTO of Podio, and a lot of what I learned there, I tried to bring forward into Peakon and make not quite as many mistakes. We still make our share of them, but hopefully a bit smarter. I'm the kind of guy who likes to build stuff. Probably not really meant to be a CTO, more of an engineer that likes to code all day long. And that sort of also reflects in the things I do and that I value. About Peakon, we're an employee engagement platform. We try to figure out what makes people happy at their work and how we can support managers and leaders in making it more enjoyable for their teams. We started early 2015, roughly 2 years ago, a bit more. We have 42 employees today, and we have now 10 employees in the product. We were only like a couple in the beginning, so it was very important for us to make the most of our time. When we started out Peakon, I wrote down sort of some principles or goals I wanted to have for our product team, and here are some of them. We wanted to be responsive, we wanted to be consistent, we wanted to build components and microservices, all a lot of like technical stuff that was quite interesting. But there was sort of one thing that stuck most to me, which was that productivity is king, right? We wanted to move fast, and if we couldn't move fast, most likely someone else would overtake us before we got anywhere. And this is one thing that we focused on throughout the years, and we still sort of, we ask ourselves every 3 months, are we productive enough, or could we do better? At Podio, we started out, I was the second developer there, and we ended up being 30, I think. But somehow it felt we were not really moving any faster compared to the beginning. And that was like enormously frustrating, and I felt that that could be done better. I think we did move faster, but you always look back in the early days as the golden days where you could do anything in 2 days. But definitely I felt there was room for improvement. So how do you define this productivity? This is sort of my take on it. Productivity is the ability to build stuff quickly. How fast can you move from sort of idea to implementation? The flip side of that is effectiveness, right? You have to build the right stuff. I have really no idea how to do that. Luckily, someone else here tonight had good ideas on how to do that. I think it's really, really hard. And you can put up lots of frameworks and processes, but you'll probably get it wrong at least some of the time. And my idea was that if we could do it very quickly, it was okay to fail quite a number of times because we could run quickly and try another time. So that's why at least I felt that productivity was something I could contribute to, and that was sort of more in my control than maybe some of the other parts. So this will basically just be some examples. It's a very simple talk, but hopefully you can be a bit inspired about what we did and how you can do things. Interface testing is probably one of those things I hate the most. It's like you change something somewhere, you're pretty sure it works, but it's probably a good idea to spin up a browser, click two things, and make sure that it actually still works the way you thought it did. It takes a long time, and you end up doing it again and again and again and again and again. Or you don't do it at all, because you get lazy, and then probably something will break. In Peakon, a part of the product is facing our customers' customers, so to speak, right? Our customers is the HR people in big companies, and their customers are the employees, right? And if we send out a survey to them about employee engagement and it doesn't work, our customers will be very unpopular internally in their companies. So that's the one thing we want to make sure always works. It cannot fail. And if you combine that with the sort of the desire to move very quickly, you have to be quite careful, right? So what did we do? There's a sort of technology called Selenium, which is basically a way to control a browser from code. So you can like open this browser, go to this page, find this button, click it, did the right thing appear, go back, go forward, do all these kind of things that a tester would generally do. Only it can do it very quickly and it can do it all the time. So we did this from the very beginning. We set up a Selenium test for what we call our survey that clicks through it, enters some comments, does a lot of stuff, changes their mind, go back, go forward, and at the end make sure that everything worked okay. we run this on any change, right? So any change we do to the system, it runs the whole set through, make sure it always works. So when we deploy, we're actually completely confident that it works. And it's been run thousands and thousands of times over the last 2 years. I don't know how many hours we saved. I definitely didn't want to do it manually. Right now it runs roughly 20 times a day. We expanded it to cover pretty much all the product. Takes 8 minutes, and when it's done, we are sort of we can be sure that the change we did, it won't break anything really bad. There might still be bugs. It cannot find anything, but at least we didn't break the world. At the same time, we run it every night. So we use a product called Source Labs, which basically can spin up a browser, different versions, a different OS, and so on. So we test in the 5 different browsers we support, and we use different versions, right? So we use IE10 on Windows 7, and we use IE Edge on Windows 10, and we also take some versions in between, because browsers also behave differently in between to the version ranges you have. So this runs every night, and it gives us a lot of confidence that the basic part of the product always works. So this is a video. Let's see if I can click it. Yeah. This is just to show you a little bit what it actually looks like. Maybe. Is it online, this computer, or who's the?
Yes, yeah, it's streaming to it.
All right. That's a.
Is it going to come back on my attention?
Oh, there we go. So this is basically Source Labs in action, right? So it starts up an IE10. We tell it to go to this URL. It will start changing the language into German. Start the survey. It will sort of answer one of our questions, and it will go back, and it will do a lot of things that our users tend to do. It will answer a comment, I think, in a minute. Go back to the start, and so on and so forth, right? And if you imagine this runs every day in all the different browsers, a different OS and so on, you get a pretty good coverage of sort of the core of your product. And this again allows us to be quite aggressive on building the product, right? We can take some chances because we know the basics work. All right, get out of this again. So next one, and something that's sort of dear to my mind, translations, like for developers, is just really, really a pain. I think everyone I talk to hate it. It's always product managers coming over to you, asking for a little change. Can you change this one? There's a typo here. It has to be out in production right now. And generally just very, very annoying. And it's one of those things that like each sort of maintenance of the translation system is only like 2 minutes, 5 minutes, so it doesn't seem that bad, but over a couple of years it really, really adds up. So we decided to try and like scale for the future here quite early on. So we picked a platform called Crowdin, which basically does translations and does it really well. They encounter many more edge cases than we will ever do. It works really well for all parts of the tool chain, right? So it works well for translators, it works well for proofreaders, it works well for these agencies to sort of manage the process. So if you pick a good platform for your core sort of problem, it will probably scale with you. I think that's also the point that Brian made, that you have to pick something where they are the experts, right? That's all they care about is translations. So that really, really helps you. So they have an API, also a very good point, right, that we can build up against, and we can automate a lot of the manual tasks around that. The list here is some of the things we did, right? So when developers add a new translation key, it's automatically added to the file, and we can push it up to Crowdin very, very easily with just a click of a button, and then they can start translating. We do what we call English to English translation. So usually when the copy is made before the feature is not final, it's sort of just in work in progress. And this allows the translators or the PMs to translate sort of the draft English into the final English that we'll use on our site. We can do sort of minute-to-minute update observations, right? So when translators go into the crowd in and do the translation, we update the system minute-to-minute, right? So they can go to the system, check to Peakon, go and check that it makes sense in the context, that it looks good, that there's room for the translations, that is consistent with the other text on the page. This really gives you a much better translation than you would otherwise. When we deploy, it also pulls in the latest translations. So whenever we deploy, we have the latest translations. And we have like a module for definitions, right? So there's a lot of formatting of dates and other things that has to get right. And we have that one central place, so it's really easy to add a language. What came out of this is sort of this picture, which actually became an advantage for us. We'd never planned on doing this many languages. It seems silly. But because we had the whole system set up, we could add a new language quite easily and quite cheaply. And it became a thing we could actually compete on, right? So we could tell customers all over the world that no problem, we'll add your language and make it work. More examples. Building. So this is the process of taking in code and then making sure the final system on the servers is updated. It's something where you can get a lot of for an engineering team, you get a lot of value very, very easily. It takes not a lot of investment, and you really raise the bar on quality and sort of time saved. We went through multiple different systems. First, we used something called Semaphore. We tried Travis, got a bit annoyed with them, ended up on something called Circle CI, which has been really good. It's quite a modern platform. It's very flexible. Again, as someone mentioned, right, you have a very flexible platform that does one thing really well, an API and everything. Most likely, it will work with other systems and your system. What do we have? We have a fully automated build and deploy. Right, so whenever we push some code, it will do all the builds and tests and packaging and updates and deploy it to our environments. No manual work required at all. There's no supervision. You know, you can trust the system to do the right thing. It will have a lot of faulty checks, sort of validate that itself that everything sort of will work before it updates the final production systems. And it looks a bit like this. I'm as a developer. I'm done with my chains. It will do a check of the what's called linting, right? It'll make sure that the source code is formatted the right way. It doesn't have any obvious mistakes in it. Then it will push to a Circle CI, which will install a lot of like other services, like databases, stuff that it needs to run the tests. It will install all dependencies. It will do a full test run, meaning all the automated tests. We have roughly 6,000 now at Peakon. It will do a code coverage, meaning how well were our tests, how much of the code was covered. It will do a security check, so we'll check all our dependencies and see if there's any known security vulnerabilities there and stop the build if so. Then it will update Heroku, which is our production environment. It will install again the dependencies. It will update the translation. It will do what we call a dry run, so we'll start all the services up, make sure they're up and running and responding, and then shut it down again. It will do migrations, meaning updates to the database. It will update a lot of tracking, right? So we use Rollbar for error reporting, Upbeat for performance, Slack for communication. So we'll send notifications to all of these systems to make sure that that is sort of tracked that now we did an update. Finally, we'll restart all the servers and then do the full UI test I mentioned earlier. So all this without any sort of work from our side, we set it all up and now we can just update the system all day long without any worries. Final example, I think, is the sign assets. So our designers, they also like to move quick and managing these designs and their versioning and sharing it with developers and extracting all the little icons and communicating around these designs is quite a time killer. There's actually some good tools for this today. We use something called Zeppelin. Designers, they can work in Sketch or whatever they like, export their designs to Zeppelin with a single click, and then it's available to everyone in the product team. It exports stuff like the font size, the coloring, the margins, the paddings, all the assets, right? You can get all the little icons that's there, all the pictures can be downloaded separately and ready to use. So it saves a lot of time for the engineers. We don't have to go and bother the designers all the time. The design's always up to date. We have a full repository of all the designs we ever did. We can discuss them in place, right? So we can point somewhere on the design, ask a question, designer can respond. So it really sort of improves the process around designs, which can be quite painful otherwise. It looks a bit like this. So this is an upcoming feature we're working on. All these little icons can be exported directly into like both PNG in normal and resonant resolution to SVG. There's a bit of discussion points here. Someone did some comments here and there, and it really makes it easy to work with. You can see some margins and column layout stuff. So much easier for developers to get it right the first time. Designers, they hate it when the margins are not quite right or stuff is not aligned. So easier to get it right the first time. So the final points. I think you should iterate on your automation and tooling, not just your product. It's easy to forget, but it really helps you be nimble and productive going forward. There's often a fear of automation, saying that it will take a long, long time. Too complex, it's not worth the investment, but you only really know if you try, right? So that's what we usually do. We spend an hour, 2 hours, let's see if we can automate this and make this in a better way. Sometimes it just works. Sometimes you realize, okay, this is way too complicated, I'll have to wait for another time. I think you should be ahead of the curve, right? Sometimes, and also on tooling, there's sometimes this tendency to say, okay, what's my problem right now today? And you solve for that, but you need to solve for the future, right? You know, you realize that half a year from now, your scale will be bigger, your problems will be bigger, and if your platform already supports it, or your tool supports it, you're in a much better shape. This is true for a lot of things in startups, but especially here. If you cannot yet automate it, a very good sort of backup plan is just formalizing it, and formalizing can be just writing it down. At least you know what the process is. You have sort of roughly the steps you need to automate, and someone else will be able to do it for you also. What I found also is that I forget. Like I think, I know how to do this, no problem. I'll do half of it, some I'll forget. There'll be bugs and things I didn't really do properly. And if you have just a very short document describing how to do it, it really saves you time. Yes? That's it. Thank you.